Okay, we ready?
Just about.
Let's go.
We're on the Bon Jovi Talk podcast this time. I've got a good friend of mine called Ollie, massive Bon Jovi fan, been to quite a few shows together and spent a lot of time together, certainly over the past couple of months. So as always, I always let the guests introduce themselves. So Ollie, I'll let you introduce yourself first.
Hey everyone, I'm Ollie from Leicester. I've been to 41 Bon Jovi shows, been a fan for 20 years now, all over Europe, and well, America is what I've been to see them. So yeah, not so much the last couple of years, but still doing the shows and whatnot, and there we go, really.
So you said there that you've been to 41, and obviously you said it's kind of, you're doing a bit less than you usually do, as tours have gone on, but you've still done every show in the UK leg. So what keeps you coming back to seeing the band?
I suppose it's the friends I've accumulated along the way, yourself included. It's a way of, not so much now, I don't think, because obviously I'm married, got a little one and stuff, but it used to be very much so when I was single back in the day. It was my holiday, so I'd do the concerts and have a 2-week block off, and I'd do all I can, pop to Europe for a few days, and there we go. But of course, the shows, more so this time 10 years ago, but as we all know, if you get the right show, it's magical, really, isn't it? Go and get the right songs you want, the right atmosphere, it can be spot on. So it's just being there. I always enjoy it, always make the most of whatever the show is, but you're always hoping you're going to get one of those little gems, really.
So tell us some of the shows that you have been to, any standouts, or obviously you said you've been to America, and I know you've been to, I think it's Barcelona as well, haven't you?
Yeah, Lisbon, Munich. I'd say even when I very first started getting into them, when I was very young, went on the Bounders tour to Wolverhampton. That's my first show. For me, that was fantastic. Always going to hold very fond memories. But on the whole, it was just a standard Midlands show, very basic, nothing special. But I loved it. But there's been a few good ones. The opening of the O2, first time I saw them indoors. That was absolutely amazing, the atmosphere for that one. Really was. I'd say it's more moments, like the last O2 show on the residency that played, what was the song that played, Hard Letting You Go. But everyone makes that absolutely amazing show, this, that and the other. In all honesty, the show was very average, very basic for the majority. It was just the last couple of songs of the encore. It just took off, everyone left buzzing. And it's more tiny moments, I'd say, but the probably highlight concert-wise probably would be Barcelona 2011 over Lisbon, I'd say.
Wow.
Just the electricity of it from start to finish, 100%. Fans amazing, band amazing. Like, so I believe, something to believe in, something I always wanted to hear, never thought I would. And so for me, again, even though everyone shouts about Lisbon being the best show that tour, had all these rarities and get ready and whatnot, for me, Barcelona probably stands out as being the one.
How high up does Lisbon actually stand in, like, your top shows? Is it up there?
I'd say it's around average, in all honesty, the bulk of the show, because if you look at the actual majority of the set, forgetting the encore, because that was something else, but the majority of the set, Get Ready, I think, I'm sure it's Get Ready, it's definitely a song off of the first album, went down like a lead balloon, no one knew it. Any Other Day went down like a lead balloon, so even though it was good to hear, it probably wasn't the time and place for the band to play those types of songs.
Where was you in the actual venue? Was your Gold Circle or...?
Gold Circle, so not Diamond, but Gold. So it's kind of middly, well, I'd say about a third towards the front, because the circles are massive.
And it's still went down like that, Get Ready, still went down.
You're the person. The crowd were good, people were enjoying it. But I would say a lot of these shows, people make out to be something absolutely amazing. But what's good, don't get me wrong, everyone left really happy, the encore was amazing. But majority of it wasn't as absolutely amazing as you might think. I'd say a couple.
Sorry, I was just going to say, what shows did you go and see in 2013?
2013. So it was Slane Castle,
yeah,
Hyde Park, pretty much identical set list. It's very underwhelming.
Yeah.
Ignore the dog there. Dog's tail flapping about. Trying to think what else there was in 13 now. Birmingham, Villa Park. That's actually a good, decent show, to be honest. That was all right, that was. And Etihad, Manchester.
Oh, okay, so I done three with you. Then I had done Slane, High Park and Manchester, but I didn't go to the Villa one. So what was different about the Villa one to the other three? Because obviously I didn't go to that one, as I just said.
Well, for me, it's probably a little bit of an expectation differences, I guess. Mm-hmm. I wasn't expecting anything.
Yeah.
Maybe that rubbed off on the band. Maybe they thought not so much was expected of them, that the shackle was off a little bit. They could, even though it's not a very big venue, they probably thought, you know what, we can try a couple of different things. I think they played a couple of songs like Happy Now and Amen, one of the few songs off that album we actually really liked.
Yeah.
So they mixed it up a little bit. Nothing amazingly rare, but I think probably the band had a bit more fun. And for me, who had been to a few shows that week, it was an ideal one to catch because it just felt a bit fresh.
Well, Slane Castle was my first one outside of like Manchester, let alone anywhere else. And I remember coming away, I wouldn't say very disappointed, but I was quite disappointed because Dublin's such we always get decent shows there and John seems to love the place. But I remember being a little bit underwhelmed. What was your thoughts on Slane Castle? We've never really spoke about it, to be honest. So what was your impression?
Well, I'd say compared to doing both the Dublin shows at the RDS in 2011, I think it was the fan club shows. If you've seen the set list for those, they're absolutely crazy. I know it wasn't going to be anything like that, but it was just the pure Bon Jovi by numbers, like your Hyde Park, playing to the masses, trying to please your casual fans a bit too much, possibly. And it was just like a very well-rehearsed, polished performance, I guess. A lot of people probably would have gone away thinking, absolutely amazing, if they've not got the latest few Bon Jovi albums and just want to hear the obvious songs. Perfect. You can see why John does it. It ticks a box and keeps people coming back, obviously. Yeah. But no, as a fan going to Dublin, you expect something a bit different from your run-of-the-mill shows. And it was a long show, as you probably remember. Best part 3 hours, if not 3 hours.
Yeah.
But my God, there was a lot of lulls in there, a lot of boring moments. And no, it's disappointing, definitely.
Yeah. So 2013 was, I presume, was your first time seeing Phil X as well?
Yes.
Yeah, so it's kind of, not because of him, but obviously things started going slightly downhill. John's vocals have dropped significantly since 2013. What's your impression of Phil X?
I don't think you can knock him as a musician, as a session musician. That's all he is. It's all he is in the nicest possible way. I think I've said before, there's hundreds of guitarists out there who could come and do the same job. But he hasn't got that magic with John. But I think you'd be amazed if someone did come in and had the magic with John. It can't be quite right, regardless. I think in the circumstances, John's found someone who can do the job right. He looks the part, he fits in with the fans, this, that and the other, gives a good impression. But it's missing a bit of magic when Richie was there.
Yeah.
It really is, and it's almost like when Richie was there, when you've seen songs like I've seen him play in the past, like you're Hard Letting You Go and things like that, it's Rich, the band are all there, they can play what they want at the end of the day. John might have to struggle and remember the lyrics, but end of the day, anything can happen. But now with Phil X, it's almost like, look, these are the songs we physically can play.
Yeah.
We can't go out of this safety net, even if we want to. So in the circumstance, fair enough, but it's never been the same without Richie.
No. No, definitely not. And as we said there, that's not even knock and fill. It's just, it's never going to be the same. How did you get introduced to the band?
It was literally hearing It's My Life on the radio.
Okay.
I must have been about 11, 12. I can remember I used to have little cassettes that I used to record like your top 10 on or whatever, my favourite songs. So I'd sit there as soon as the song I wanted to record would come on. As soon as the talking had finished, bang, I'd record it. And I had it on playback, basically. And my dad heard me listening to it. And he kind of come in, who's that you're listening to? Bon Jovi. Got nothing else of it. He kept on listening to it. He come in again and said, he's friends with Bruce Springsteen, you know. So my dad's a massive Springsteen fan. It's like, if you like Bon Jovi, I'll get you some of the CDs from the library so we can copy them and you can have a good listen to them. I think because about 18 months prior to that, obviously I was like 10, 11, 12, a lot of changes were happening.
Yeah.
I was growing up a lot, shall we say. So about 18 months previous, I think I was badgering my dad to take me to go and see Steps and PJ and Duncan live in Big Damn Pub, literally. So I think he thought, hold on, if I can actually get him into some decent music, I'm going to try my best to help him along his way. So my dad got all the Bon Jovi albums, I think two a week from the local library where you could get your CDs from. We'd copy them, and that was it, really. And I think around the time as well, we'd have done a Top of the Pop special. I think it was only about 7 or 8 songs, an hour special, but I had that recorded on VHS. I'd always been listening to that.
Yeah.
And then they were touring, playing Huddersfield, and the One More Night's Up. Did they take me to go and see them live? No chance. They thought it was just a whim, even then. They thought life goes into your steps and things like that. Not much before that, in all honesty, because I was growing up. They thought it was just like, yeah, he's into it now, but this time next year he won't be.
Yeah.
So they didn't, but no, just went from there.
Do you regret not going to the Huddersfield show?
Oh, big time, but in all honesty, I know I've done everything I could to get there.
Yeah.
I was at the age where I couldn't do anything. I couldn't go.
Yeah.
I was 12 years old. It's not round the corner. it would have been before that. It would have been about 10, 11, because I think I was 12 or 13 when I saw them on the bounce tour.
Okay.
Yeah, so I would have literally been around 11.
So was Wolverhampton your first show, did you say, in 2003?
Yes.
So Describe that show for us, because I can remember mine quite clearly. Mine was 2003, but I want to hear somebody else's impression of the 2003 shows.
No, definitely. Well, I'd say I was very tuned into the band. I knew what was happening. I had a massive bootleg collection of Bon Jovi by then. I had a website, I had well over 200 bootleg CDs, VCDs as well, so I'd watched numerous shows from your Japanese leg of the tour that had already happened, for example, and I think part of the American leg might have already happened by then as well, so I roughly knew what to expect. I was following the set lists as well as heavy onto your message boards as well, so I roughly knew what to expect. But now I thought it was fantastic. All comes down to expectations.
Yeah.
If I'd been to Huddersfield, if I'd been to Wembley in 2000, it might have been totally different, because that's my first time seeing the band. It was absolutely amazing for me, really was, from start to finish, just seeing the band do the thing. Even though I sat up in your seats on the top tier, for me it was, it was spot on, it really was.
Did you get anything out of the ordinary on that show?
No, it was literally as vanilla as you can get, 100%.
Was it, yeah.
It really was, but it's one of those. Some of the songs I played, like, you know, you'd die for now to hear them played in that kind of format, but they still got Captain Crash even back then.
As a regular. So, I don't know if you're aware, but 2020 is being postponed. There's no date on it, but it looks like it's going to be postponed. And we've heard two songs already. I've been saying recently, we've already heard a fifth of the album, which probably sounds worse than it is, but we've heard two songs out of the 10. What are your thoughts on Unbroken and Limitless so far?
I'd say the most worrying thing is, if they're the two songs they're putting out promotion-wise, that's the scary thing. Mm. Like, in all honesty, if you look at the last few albums with your songs that have come out first, you probably argue that the lead singles are far from the best songs, in all honesty.
Yeah.
But outside looking in, shall we say, I don't think we can have too high hopes what with John... what his voice can do and how limited they are. I'm not hopeful.
Yeah.
Not hopeful. But even the last album, like, the amount of times I've listened to it, very minimal, shall we say.
Yeah.
There always used to be songs on Bon Jovi albums that drag you back to listen again. There'd be hooks, there'd be songs you'd listen over and over again, but there's nothing, you listen to an album or two and that's it. There's nothing to get you back now, unfortunately. One of those.
Yeah, I agree with you there. Like, as much as I say, I like this house is not for sale, it's not something where I'd show anyone it, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
As much as I like it, there's nothing that stands out really. The odd little part, but nothing major. I was thinking the other day actually that as bad as John's voice is now, I actually think I preferred the 2019 shows that we went to than the 2013. I don't know whether you feel the same, but it could have been an expectation. I had no expectations going into the 2019 shows. Whereas 2013, as I said, we got Slane Castle, so I was thinking, yeah, this is going to be unbelievable. We got Hyde Park, and I thought that's going to be another unbelievable show, and it wasn't. Manchester, I thought, was probably the better show of the three, but I just thought 2019 was just, I don't know if it was because we were all together again and it made the show a little bit better, but I don't know about you. Did you find that the 2019 shows were better than 2013, or...
I had an absolute ball, whether it was alcohol infused or like someone being together, the occasion it had been. I obviously saw them in New York the year before, but from the last time I saw them in a big outdoor setting, it was 6 years, so it's a long time.
Yeah.
But a little bit of expectation. I think had we done the tour, it probably started off on a high, then the rest of the tour was almost trying to keep up to the Dublin standard, shall we say.
Yeah.
Dublin was fantastic. The shows were short and to the point, shall we say.
Yeah.
Energy-wise, John, you can't knock it much better than 2013.
Yeah.
His voice, it's how much you're going to critique it. If you're there in the moment, he's effort-wise, you can't knock him one bit.
Yeah.
I think you can't knock that off. Like I said, Dublin was fantastic. Just the pure energy with the crowd and what the band were giving in the circumstance. Whether John's learned to up his game a little bit, possibly. That maybe he's thinking the 2013 tour, maybe something was missing with Richie, as he thinks, so maybe he's got to be on the game a little bit more.
Yeah.
So, especially the first Dublin show, I think, if my memory serves me right. He's bouncing around like you'd expect him to, like he almost was on the One World Night live recording.
Yeah.
The Giants took 2001.
Well, it's mad because one expectation that you went to, as you said, the two Madison Square Garden shows in the year in 2018, and I remember you saying just before Dublin Night One that both shows were identical in the main set.
Yeah.
And leading up to that then, I was thinking, oh, we're going to get two different sets, similar to 2011, nowhere near that standard, but you're going to get two completely different shows. And then when you said that you went to the two Madison Square Garden and you were identical, I was like, oh, shit, like, we're not going to get...
Yeah.
Anything here, and we got 6 or 7 changes, but you spent a lot of money going to Madison Square Garden. Obviously, America isn't cheap. What were them shows like for you?
Well, there's a bit of a story behind it, to be fair. Why I went, shall we say?
Okay.
Like, I remember the first time I went to New York to see Bon Jovi, what's now the MetLife Stadium, 2010. Went to those three shows. With my very good friend Ryan, and we landed there, and I only just noticed the day we landed, Pearl Jam were playing at Madison Square Garden. At the time, I always wanted to go MSG, most renowned venue in the world, in New York, in Manhattan. So I was like, right, we've got to go to those shows. Searching online everywhere. I sold out, as you'd imagine. So, right, I said, that's right, we're going to get a ticket. Let's see what we can do. So we're walking around the venue, touts everywhere, look as dodgy as you can imagine. Police ignoring them, they're too dodgy even for the police to approach. The police are leaving them to it. They're wanting something ridiculous, like $500 a ticket. So we spoke to loads of them. We thought, we'll give it until about an hour and a half before the concert, the prices will come down. They didn't. So we thought, right, we'll give up, we'll just go to a bar. We did. And then by chance, American folk was walking past, anyone need a ticket for the gig, anyone need a ticket, and literally one of their friends, they went to pick him up and he just wasn't in or called it off or whatever, he hadn't turned up. So we got a ticket for, I think it was about $60, so I'm thinking, even if we pay $500 a ticket, between us, collectively, that's not actually that ridiculous.
Yeah.
We're only here, one-off chance and everything, so we get to pay a ridiculous amount of money for a ticket. Me and Ryan both going to it, both eager beaver, more me, because I'm the fan. I kind of dragged him a little bit looking back. But anyway, the ticket we got for $60 or whatever it was, Ryan went straight through. The ticket I bought, obviously spent a lot of money on it, was on the floor. Sorry, sir, this is a fraudulent ticket. You won't be coming in tonight. And I can remember, luckily with Madison Square Garden, you kind of should give them your ticket. You go through, but they don't actually stamp it or scan it until you literally go through further. There's almost like two concourses almost to get in. So Ryan managed to come out with me because he wasn't that bothered about the concert. Luckily, we managed to do a bit of touting ourselves and we sold the cheaper ticket. I think we were about double the money on the cheaper ticket, so it wasn't too bad.
Yeah.
But we kind of thought, right, we're going to go and find this tout. And literally, we found him. And there's a bit of a crowd of people. All the towels are gathered together. There's a bit of a kickoff with fans that they'd obviously done the same thing with.
Yeah.
And lo and behold, basically, the tap literally went to grab something from his jacket pocket in a, I can't remember whether I saw a gun or whether it is literally as clear as day, that's what he was getting at, back off.
Wow.
I'm armed. And that's when I looked at Ryan like, nah. Well, we'll give up. Let's just go home. We've got Bon Jovi in a few days. We lost, shall we say. But it's going from ultimate excitement. We've got a ticket. We're getting into Madison Square Garden. So knowing, lost all that money, no tickets. And ever since then, it's always been my kind of ambition. I've got to go.
Yeah.
That's why.
Wow.
Why I wanted to go. But concert-wise, Bon Jovi, very... You know what, like you said, even though there were two very similar, apart from the last couple of songs of the main set, pretty much identical. First night, I'll be honest, whether it was a bit of jet lag, I'm not sure, but I pretty much sat down through most of it. I was on the side terrace, but it just, I didn't get any, no magic feeling, shall we say, no energy. It was just very, very basic, very bland. For the best shows I've been to, shall we say, anyway. Second show, though, totally different. I'd see much more up for it that the crowd, or whether it could have been me personally, to be honest.
Yeah.
I've been beat by then, you don't quite know. But it was fantastic to go to. Pleased I've done it.
That's the main thing, I suppose. What I'm going to ask is, could you see a difference from, because a lot of people were saying that when John came to Europe, he kind of brought out like the front man, as we said, that he was very energetic. Did you notice a massive difference from the 2018 shows to the 2019 that you went to?
Oh, 2018 MSG, that was your John from 2013.
Really,
yeah. Was acoustic for the majority of the show. He knew he had to put on a show for Europe for the stadiums with no Richie anyway, because he didn't in 2013, did he?
No.
But 2019, for whatever reason, he knew he had to bring it in, and he did. It meant shorter set lists, but in all honesty, if it means a 2-hour, 20-minute set list, and John's on form compared to a 3-hour... Ball Fest, like Slane Castle in 2013, I know what I'd rather.
Oh, yeah, 100%. Yeah. So, I remember, my last show with you was Wembley. You went to Coventry the year after it. And I think Wembley, we kind of built up a little bit as well. And we, when it finished, we were a little bit underwhelmed, let's say. I mean, I still thought it was a very, very good show. I just wanted a little bit more. What are your impressions of Wembley? Was that your first time seeing them at Wembley? I imagine
then.
So what was your thoughts on that?
I don't think you can knock the gig, the energy of it. I'd say set list wise, it was what we expected. Very, very short encore. I think the downside probably was the encore. It's very short and snappy. And I think we was all expecting Bon Jovi back at Wembley for the first time. At the new Wembley, was expecting something that you wouldn't get at any other generic stadium.
Yeah.
Shall we say, but that set list, if they played that set list at, I don't know, Coventry or, for example, it wouldn't have, no one would have been shocked, shall we say. So whether we expect them to come back out afterwards and do and never say goodbye or something like that, a little bit different, not that that'd be the same without Richie, but something along those lines, we probably would have gone away thinking that was a show of the tour.
Yeah, definitely.
Because it is just a snappy 2-song encore.
Yeah.
Mythically, I suppose, always is about as rare as you're going to get for the last tour. But it just needed something, a little gold nugget at the end, just to make it feel, you know what, we've been to something prestigious.
Yeah. As you said, always is probably, as you said, as rare as we're going to get. And like that moment was still quite a special moment, but I still wanted something else. And I don't know whether I'm just being greedy or, as you said, like, you're in such an iconic stadium. The first time the band have been there for 20 years nearly. And you know, you get a 2-song encore. It was slightly disappointing, let's say. What are your predictions for 2020? The album? Do you think there's going to be one or two songs that are going to be standouts? Very similar to what's been out recently. You know, where you get one or two songs where you go, yeah, like it's almost not back to Bon Jovi, but it's like a highlight type of song. Or do you think it's just going to be as flat as the 2 songs have been so far?
I think the majority of it, what we're going to hear on the tour, is going to be as flat and as boring as what we've heard.
Yeah.
But there might be a couple of hidden gems on there, which are probably going to be the slower, more acoustic-based songs, like for me there was off the This House album. But they're not the songs they're going to touch on an arena tour or a stadium tour. There's a couple of songs off This House, fantastic songs, I thought, but probably a bit too slow or not in your face enough for the band to have the balls to play them in a stadium, I guess. So that's what I think. I think the Gems will be the songs that don't get touched on the tour myself.
Do you think Unbroken's going to be a staple? Seems
like for a long time.
Yeah.
I think that'll be almost like a Lost Highway kind of staple. The fact he can have a little speech before the song, he loves all that. He can mention the charity work and what it stands for. I think it's not just a staple for this tour. So if they do go on and do another two or three tours, I think we can expect to hear it every single night personally. It might be wrong.
No, I agree with you. And I've got a feeling as well, that Do What You Can song that is now going to be on the album as well. I've got a feeling that's going to be another one where, you know, we'll be halfway through the show and again, a lovely little story, and he'll get his acoustic guitar out and start singing that for 3 minutes as well.
Yeah. Although, to be fair, the Hall of Fame song, I was adamant he was going to milk that the whole way through last year and play every song, give a little speech. But to be fair to him, as soon as the 2018 tour finished, the song finished, which is a bit of a shame because they went on to play many a worse song on the 2019 tour than that. But see, you never quite know.
Yeah, I was disappointed not to get When We Were Us. Mm-hmm. You got it in Madison Square Garden, didn't you?
Yeah.
I really wanted that. That was one song, say from like the This House and Office Sale like stint that I really wanted to hear, and unfortunately I never got it. What I was going to ask you is, you've obviously been to 41 shows, so I want you to try and name your top three.
Barcelona.
Yeah.
I would say Meadowlands Stadium Night 1, 2010.
How come?
Whether that was because of the band being on form first night, they were right up for it, or whether it was me a little bit being there for the first time. Absolutely fantastic setting. It was absolutely buzzing. Your firework display, keep the faith, for example, really topped it off. So that's got to be up there. Probably more for being most memorable, in all honesty, rather than this critique of the band from afar, shall we say. And then show number three. It's going to be a hard one, this. Give a moment. I'm only on the Pepsi, by the way. Too early for me. Right, very hard to say. Even the O2 shows, I'll probably say the O2, but not the residency, the opening of the O2 in 2007, I think it was.
Yeah, that's interesting because that was my brother's last show, and he just didn't like it at all.
Yeah.
But kind of in a different way to us, his expectations were really low. He went to all of the 2003 shows in the UK and went to, I think, nearly all of them in 2006 and ended up selling his tickets because he just got onto how predictable they were and stuff. And, you know, I think someone kicked off in 2007 and it just ruined the show, but that was his last show. So it's interesting that that's in your top three with how many shows you've been to.
I'm sure my top three would change every week, but it's easiest to pick the shows with the best songs, shall we say, with the best set list. That doesn't mean you had the best time, the whole experience. You can't just critique it on paper, shall we say.
Yeah.
The whole experience when you go through a gig, which is why you do it. You don't just watch it online, which you pretty much can do now anyway. But I think at the time, it was very rare to be able to be that up close. I was in about the sixth row by the time I surged forward when the lights went down.
Yeah.
But by the time doing so, to be able to see the band up close in that kind of, it's not intimate, but it was intimate for Bon Jovi at the time. It was just very memorable at the time, really. This one still is, obviously. So, but it's fantastic.
How many of the New Meadowland shows did you go to in 2010?
The three. I think because what they've done, they've done the three nights on the trot over four nights, I think. So three shows in 4 days, but then they also added a fourth date, which it was about 2 months later.
Oh, okay.
Something like that. It was on, they added it on top the back end of the tour. So we didn't go back to that one, which I was pleased about, because that just got a generic set list. It didn't get the firework display.
Yeah.
So I went for all the 10 nights in Manhattan, and I went to your three nights at the stadium.
Wow. So did night one have, I can't remember off the top of my head, did night one have any rarities? Did that hold anything, you know, like significance? I know, obviously, you said it was probably the stadium and the fireworks that made it the show for you, but did Dad have any like certain songs that you didn't expect at the time?
I can, in all honesty, they all merged into one really, unless they go through the set list. The rarities really on those shows, which they had the B stage when they do acoustic songs. Like, for example, we've got Never Say Goodbye One Night, where John forgot the lyrics.
Yeah.
Trying to remember some of the others, but they were the kind of gems that you got, acoustic. So, like,
Something for the Pain, was that?
Yeah.
Then? Yeah.
Yeah, that one there, yeah. So, and again, where we were sat was pretty much bang on the B stage, so you could pretty much search the B stage and you'd be in like the second, third row.
Yeah.
Who's that close to the band in that kind of stadium? When there was on up there with the Prime, it was nailed spot on, really was. But no, I don't think there's any specific songs. I think in the encore we got, I think, Dry County, Two Nights of the Three, and Always One Night of the Three.
Yeah.
So, again, like I said, there was nothing out of this world, I don't think, set list wise. But then I don't think we really expect that, really, with the American shows and such. Anyway, but
I think it's good, though, that you've been to so many shows, and like, as you said, the Lisbon one's like a stand-up show for everyone because of the set list, all the other shows that you've been to, and yeah, you still, you know, the O2 show in 2007, never had nothing like spectacular set list-wise, really.
Yeah.
Obviously, New Meadowlands isn't really one where it's kind of one I'll go back to look at the set list, so it's interesting that they're, like, in your top three. It just shows that as long as they put on a good show, a solid show, and it's enjoyable enough, it's enough for us, really.
Oh yeah, it's true. Don't need anything out of this world setlist-wise. But it's one of those, again, it all comes down to expectation, what the crowd brings, what the band brings. It's hard to put, because you couldn't just say to John, replicate the setlist from Meadowlands Night 1, and it'd be amazing. It'd probably be awful if they'd done it again.
Yeah.
So it's hard to say, really. Yeah. But it's so specific on the individual, I think. But even Munich's had a very average set list the last few tours.
Yeah, it has.
When I went to Munich in 2011, I think it was, again, cracking show, cracking atmosphere, but people keep on going back thinking it's going to be this kind of prestigious set list, shall we say. But it keeps on getting good reviews, even though the set list isn't there. From what I can gather, it's still the place to go.
Yeah.
So that's another kind of thing. Might not get the best set list, but if the show's good, it's one of those. Where to draw the line, though? You can't go all over the world watching them on the hope it's going to be a good show, knowing you're not going to get that set list at the same time.
Exactly, certainly now, anyway. I obviously never went to the Coventry show, and I was really debating going. And I remember You Give Love a Bad Name opened the show, and I wanted something different over the four shows that we went to. And I thought Dublin Night 2, we might have got Bad Name as an opener, because I've never heard it open a show. And when I seen Bad Name open Coventry, I was like, oh, here we go, like, this is going to be something special here, you know, last show of the UK leg. Describe the show for me, because it's been a bit hit and miss with a lot of people, that show, so I want to hear your opinion on the Coventry gig.
How to describe it? I think, like you said, it started off different, so we're kind of thinking the shackles are off. The last show of the European tour, I think, no, of the first leg of the European tour. It's got a few days off afterwards. Probably the smallest crowd they've played to in England, anyway.
Yeah.
Have a bit more fun. They've kept things safe on the whole, I would say, in the England tour so far, the three England shows so far. It was kind of like anything goes, you're thinking. Literally after when that opened, you kind of think anything goes, literally. But I think the longer it went on, you knew it was just going to go to turn into vanilla, shall we say. Energy-wise, you can't lock John like he was at Dublin, at Liverpool, at Wembley, jumping around all over the place. But as soon as I went to the encore, you're just thinking, this is it. It's, I think it was a two song encore again. I think it was I'll Be There For You and Prayer, I think.
Yeah.
But again, it's a good show. Too short, I think, for a stadium, because there's still a lot of bums on seats.
Yeah.
Probably still talking the best part of 35,000 people there. But a good energy show, good show all around. But again, I think it needed a bit more just to be a average on par show. That's not me. It just needed an extra song or two just to bring it on, so it could even attempt to be on par with your Liverpool, shall we say.
Well, that's interesting because Liverpool was the one show that I couldn't wait for. Obviously, big Liverpool fan, they've never played Anfield before. I think you know more than anyone. I was quite disappointed with it, and I think it was just down to being so close at the front. I just didn't feel there was much of an atmosphere that I was. The show was still very, very good. As you said, John's energy was unbelievable. But I remember meeting you after it, and you was like, the whole crowd was just really up for it. And it's mad. Like, I want you to describe the Liverpool show, because as I said, for me, whenever I've done these podcasts, I've always gone, it was a decent show, but it was probably the worst of the four for me. And I think, again, I've put it up there with my expectations, and it's a lesson learned, but it was probably the worst of the four, as I said, because I was queuing up from 9 o'clock and I really couldn't be bothered. When we got there, it was boiling hot and we were all dead tight, and it was just a strange show for me, but you seem really positive about it.
Yeah, well, obviously experience it totally different from you. I think I got into the stadium a couple of songs into the Manic Street Preachers, hovered around the back of the circle, easy access to pop for a drink, for example, as well. So I watched it from the back of the circle, loads of space, not that it's ridiculous space, but it wasn't crammed up. But no, energy levels were fantastic, of the band, that is, not me. good set list, strong set list, got even that. You know, I mean, nothing amazing, but it kept the fans going. But literally, the stands, forget the fans on the floor, literally the stands, everyone was standing, even right at the back, dancing away, clapping away, all the way through. Atmosphere was absolutely buzzing. But you probably take it for granted, being a Liverpool supporter, but my God, that ground is so enclosed. The stands are literally on the pitch, so the atmosphere, the sound kind of whirling around inside that stadium, I thought was amazing.
It is. I'm a bit disappointed, and as I've said to you, I'll never queue up again, because Dublin Night 2, we were right at the back, and we had so much space, and we were just dancing around, and Wembley was the same, and I just found it so much better at the back of the circle than up close, and like, it was... As glad as I was to the positive reviews, I was kind of thinking, I feel like I've missed out a little bit because, you know, whether they'll ever play there again, I don't know. And it was just a very 50-50 show for me. But a lot of people who were in the seats said that the sound wasn't great. How was it for you at the back of the circle?
It was absolutely fine.
Was it, yeah?
I can't remember thinking... It was fantastic. I can't remember thinking it was poor. It was just as you'd expect. Yeah. I think there's no memory of me clocking it, what's going on here.
Yeah.
Nothing at all. But
I don't think I've ever asked you this. What's your favourite album?
Favourite album, I'd have to say, these days.
Yeah. I think it's a lot. Go
album that I can happily listen to start to finish. I don't think there's a bad song. Song on there. No sellers for me.
Is it the last great album by the band for you?
Depends what you mean by great really. Mm. For me, Bounce still had it. I probably didn't appreciate it enough at the time.
Yeah.
For me, Bounce has aged ridiculously well for me. It really has. Crush is up there as well. Again, it's what you're comparing it to. Like, in all honesty, my music taste, it's probably more 90s Bon Jovi, early Millennium Bon Jovi, but like, in all honesty, I think if I was around in the 80s as a music fan, I probably wouldn't have been a Bon Jovi fan.
Really?
I'll put my hand up. Yeah, it's only probably because of the stuff I've heard when I got into the early noughties and the mid-90s albums. Like, when my dad used to get the albums, it was actually Keep the Faith and These Days, and they were two of the very first albums he got me.
Yeah.
Just by choice. I think if it wasn't for me loving the band, what I'd heard already, I don't think if it wasn't for me then going back and exploring and really investing time into getting into your album tracks on the 80s albums, if it was just those standalone, I probably wouldn't have been invested in the band as much, to be honest. If it was just you living on a prayers and you give up a bad name that I know, and I like them, I don't think I'd be at the stage of being calling myself a fan going off the 80s albums, in all honesty, which is probably not something many a Bon Jovi fan would say.
So that gets me to ask then, where are Slippery and New Jersey and like your top albums, are they up there, or like even now, rather than, you know, if you were in back then, you know, as a fan in the 80s, is it up there for you now, them two albums?
It's hard to say, like, critically, shall we say, if you're actually rating the album, then I think they've got to be definitely both in your top in the top five.
Yeah.
Definitely, but I'd say when it comes to the most listened to albums, probably not when it comes to listening to them from start to finish.
Wow, that's interesting. Well,
yeah, probably not up there for me personally, but obviously fantastic albums. Like the one song that's always passed me by live is Wild Is the Wind. Always missed it. But then I think I said to a couple of people, you know what, it's annoying because I keep on missing it, but I'm not actually that bothered by it. It's one of those, it's not one of my songs, Something to Believe In, that was different. I was all over the place trying to hear that song.
Yeah.
But Wild As a Wind, I'm not actually that bothered by it as such. However, good a song it is, but it's just not, I wouldn't say it's up there for me.
So have you only heard Something to Believe In once?
Yeah.
Wow. Bloody
yeah. Hell. I didn't go to the O2 show at the residency. I missed it at the residency. And funnily enough, on the 2011 tour, I was working in Scunthorpe at the pub at the time.
Yeah.
And Ryan and Janine, I think it was, I'm not sure, I think it was just the two of them, came up to stay with me at the pub because we had little rooms upstairs and whatnot. And they got there on the morning of the Edinburgh show. And I was toying with the idea, you can still get your cheap tickets on eBay and whatnot. I was toying with the idea, shall we drive up to Edinburgh, about from Scunthorpe? I think it was about a 3.5-4 hour journey. They were getting to me about 11:30 in the morning. I was thinking, shall we pop up and go to the show before we get off to the rest of the tour, before we do Manchester and Hyde Park, I think it was. But decided against it at the time. But lo and behold, you had Wild Is the Wind and Something to Believe In. And at that time, I never heard Something to Believe In. So I was absolutely fuming that I didn't do it in the end. But just sort of slow, isn't it?
So what was your reaction when you did actually get it?
I was mad. I think it's on YouTube somewhere, my reaction and my awful singing.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, but it was Barcelona was just magical all around. The band coming out when it's pitch black, when you actually see the visual of the introduction, shall we say. And I think even the fans over there, you can tell they're properly up for it. It's not something they do multiple times a year, going to concerts. They're all there to have a party, shall we say. And now it's cracking. They open the encore with it. So as soon as they heard those drums, I knew it was coming.
Yeah, that's one, I've always said I've been to, I think, 12 shows now, but I've never really heard anything that's, significantly rare, Something to Believe In or Hey God or anything, so I can't even imagine what you must have been like to have been to so many shows and then not get it, and then pass and then, to get it.
Yeah, and then 2 days later, obviously, in Lisbon, when you get your Santa Love song.
Yeah.
So, and again, that made the whole show, that song.
Did it,
again, another one, if they didn't play that song, because we knew it was in the mix, shall we say, because I played it at San Sebastian a couple of shows before, if they didn't play it, you probably all would have gone home a little bit disappointed, but because they played it, it's the best show going. It's one of those, it's one song can change the whole perception of the concert sometimes, I think, for people.
So, you're a massive, I think you was a massive Manic Street Preachers fan, wasn't you?
I'm not sure if you're saying massive. Like, in all honesty, Send Away the Tigers album, I think it was 2004, possibly. Mm-hmm. Really got into that album. I'll be honest, hold my hands up. I went off and bought the greatest hits, and I bought the releases after that, and never invested in really digging into the older stuff.
Yeah.
But up until about the last couple of tours, I'd always go and see them live. But on the whole, they'd always be playing local shows, so it's never a ridiculous kind of investment or whatnot, get into the shows, but I'd always have a Friday night out or whatnot and go to my local Manic show.
Yeah. So what was your impression of them opening for Bon Jovi? One, when it got announced, and two, actually being there and seeing them open for the band?
It was much better than you'd expect compared to your competition winners.
Yeah.
They're obviously there for a reason, one reason only, to help sell tickets.
Yeah.
A bit of a contrast in the actual artist, like how many Manic Street Preachers fans where you can go and see them play for 2 hours themselves in a 2,000 capacity theatre.
Yeah.
How many of those are going to pay £100 plus to go and see them play 45 minutes and then watch a Bon Jovi concert?
Yeah. Yeah.
They're a bit chalk and cheese when it comes to the followings and whatnot. And to say also, Manic Street Preachers, they're quite held in quite high stead, shall we say, in their kind of world of music.
Yeah.
A lot of the message boards and responses, I'm obviously friends with them on Facebook, shall we say, so I saw the announcements when it came out. There were supporting Bon Jovi from the Manic Street Preachers kind of PR team, shall we say.
Yeah.
And a lot of the fans were kicking off, we're bigger than Bon Jovi, we're better than Bon Jovi, we've been around for 20 years, we shouldn't be a support band, they should be supporting us almost. Even though we know it's ridiculous because with Bon Jovi, you're always going to sell more tickets.
Yeah.
But they're held quite high in the stead, and they're not really, a lot of fans weren't happy that they were the support band, so they won't go and see them on that basis, really. But it was good to see them. Really good live band. And they couldn't have kept it any more sane without show to show. The Manics were there for one reason only. They were on the bill for one reason only. All comes down to money that keeps the world turning, I think.
Yeah.
But served the purpose. Good to see them. And I think, obviously, was that you getting into the band, would you say, when you saw the Manics?
100%. I think I knew one or two songs. And Dublin Night One, I was pleasantly surprised by them. Because I'm kind of one of them, when the support acts on, I just want them to be over. That's usually what I've been like. I think because we get competition with us and so on.
Yeah.
And then I remember being at the back with you for Dublin Night Two, and I enjoyed them even more than Night One. And then, similar to Anfield, I really enjoyed them again. I thought, you know what, this is a band that... And I've listened to them, not every day since, obviously, the shows, but I've listened to them quite a lot since, so it's worked out in their favour that, like, they've obviously got a couple more fans. And obviously, Brian Adams was due to support the band in America in 2020, well, in the next 2 months. So what was your impression of Brian Adams supporting Bon Jovi?
Again, there for one reason only. I think that helps Brian Adams and Bon Jovi, obviously. It works both the favours. But this one makes sense for me. A lot of them follow casual fans. Of course, you've got your diehards on both sides, but the diehards aren't the ones that fill the arenas or the stadiums.
Yeah.
But this one makes sense. Your casual fan will buy a couple of tickets to go see Bon Jovi on a Saturday night for a night out with friends. They'll also probably do the same thing 6 months later with Brian Adams.
Yeah.
So this one makes sense when it comes to knocking into that kind of cliche fans, where it's literally two birds with one stone for the fans. So it makes sense. That's what I'd say. I'm not massive into Brian Adams. I'm sure I'd enjoy him if I saw him live. But it makes logical sense business-wise.
Yeah, definitely.
And fan-wise. So you can see why they're doing it.
And what I always end the podcast with, I always get the guests to tell me their top five Bon Jovi songs. It's probably a lot harder than it actually seems, but if you can, try and tell me your top five Bon Jovi songs.
Right, so I'm not going to dwell on it too much, but I'm going to go for Love Is the Only Rule as a cracking song from one of the latter albums.
Yeah, that's in my top five.
Really good song, cracking live as well. We'll go for Do I Count It? Just for the, you get a bit of everything from the song.
Yeah.
The build up, the solo, which is on form as well. Now, on the spot. I'm going to go for Wild in the Streets.
Okay, wow.
Yeah.
Think we'll ever get that live again?
No, John can't sing it, can he? Wow. His voice went, wasn't it around 2008 when his voice went in America?
The Prudential shows where they massively cracked.
Yeah. Next 100 years.
No way. Really?
Yeah.
Why is that up there so
high for you? No, that's just when I first got into the band. They always had the Zurich DVD, shall we say, back in the day as well, before I could see them live. So obviously that was always on repeat, shall we say, in my house.
Yeah.
And it's just a song that looked fantastic live.
Yeah. It's mad I actually watched that yesterday. Someone put it on Twitter. So I watched it again yesterday, that song on from the Zurich show.
Mm-hmm.
That's a surprise.
And I had to go for another one. Let me think. Got to be something to believe in.
Yeah, definitely. That's definitely in my top five, something to believe in. Well, listen, Ollie, thanks very much for coming on the podcast. If there's anything else you want to say, feel free.
Yeah, no, all good. The only show I forgot to mention was Punch It's Down, 2008.
Oh, yeah.
That was another belter. That's probably the only one I forgot to mention. That would be right up there. But again, so many, I think, muddled.
Where the woman jumped all over John on stage. What was your impression of that?
Oh, that one little occasion with John. Yeah. To be fair, he handled it quite well. Yeah, you know what he's like, spitting his dummy out and shouting at people, this, that and the other. But no, he actually handled that the right way, shall we say. So fair play to him for that.
Do you know what? You've just reminded me. That's one thing I was going to ask you about. what was the show we were speaking about the other day, and he said that John was in, you could hear him in a bad mood. What was that show?
It was Coventry. It was either 06 or 08. I want to say it was 08. But basically, it was three or four songs in. The band start Born to Be My Baby. Whether Tico got his counting wrong or something, but basically half the band came in on the wrong bar, basically. So, in all honesty, your casual fan probably wouldn't have noticed. All your prop fans down at the front noticed. It was proper muddled when the song started off. But basically, John weren't happy. He turns around, and I'll change the explicits, but it was something like at the top of his voice, what the ducking hell do you call that? Ducking joke. Sort yourselves out, or else. Something along those lines. Proper stern. You could hear him shout at the top of his voice. The funniest thing was then, I think as I mentioned, he turned around to the fans a couple of seconds later, biggest cheesy grin ever. And didn't half give a how false can you be kind of impression. But then at the same time, behind John's cheesy smile, the band looked at each other, Richie, Dave and Tico, as if to say, what a plonker. Literally, like a cheesy grin. Again, I'll probably use different words if it weren't being recorded, but literally, they literally just kind of laughed it off, like, here he goes again, it's John's on when he's spitting his dummy out. But on all the fans were kind of just kind of looking at each other, like, did that really happen? But you could tell it wasn't, again, when he makes, I think as we mentioned, when he makes mistakes and he forgets the lyrics, it's very much so laughed about and all's okay. When it's someone else, it's very, very much so, you're in for it, shall we say. But no, very, very, very interested.
Have you been to any other shows where he's kicked off like that, or he's been in a foul mood? Have you noticed he's in a foul mood in any other shows?
Not really. I never went to your famous Hulk show in 2006. I was lucky and missed out on that one. But not really. I think, again, one of the commentary ones, it could have been that show, or it could have been the alternate one. I remember there's an 06 and an 08, but one of them, we had hay fever. Right. Big glasses on all night. I think he took them off in the encore, second song in the encore. And again, he just seemed very much so, let's just get this over with, shall we say.
Yeah.
It was suffering quite a bit. But no, I wouldn't say so. That's it. From memory, that was the only one, shall we say. But in all honesty, he got over it and it was okay. It was just that it was almost like that was normal.
Yeah, was the show all right after that, yeah?
From what I can remember, I think that could have been a Coventry show where it's very basic, very vanilla, but I think they actually saved it in the end with These Days and Blood on Blood in the Encore, which is for a Midlands show. That was spot on. But again, back in the day, anything was possible. You know what I mean? With all the band there, Richie there, the show could turn on its head in a moment, really.
Definitely. Well, listen, Ollie, thanks very much for coming on and giving me some of your time. We're both in lockdown, so it's good that it's filled a bit of time for me anyway.
Good stuff, Jay.
Hopefully I get to see you soon anyway, and we'll plan a night out or a concert or something soon.
Definitely. We'll do it, Jay. My pleasure, mate.
Cheers very much, Ollie.
Cheers, mate.
Ta-ra.
Bye.
Bye.